I need to get a little bit of a running start. And there's one mind that I need to talk a little bit about before Aristotle's. That the two minds in the title are Aristotle and Newton. The first one, maybe I should call him the zeroth one, is Plato. Because Plato had some interesting ideas about how we understand the world. And that's one of the things that I think is a unifying theme for my talk today. Plato imagined a perfect world made up of things like Platonic solids that were really mathematical entities. And the reality that we know was, for Plato, just a shadow on the wall of the cave. And the people who could see the real world, that is, the shadows, could never see what was, for Plato, the underlying reality of this idealized world. Because for Plato, that idealized world was, I keep pointing behind myself, because if you're looking at the shadows, then the action is behind you. For Plato, the piece, the reality, was this idealized world that one can never touch. It is not observable directly. All we can observe is the part of the world that we see. So he had a different idea of what it meant to understand the world. A nice example is, if you asked Plato, how many teeth does a horse have? He would never go out and count teeth. That would not answer the question. What Plato would do would be to sit down and think, well, if I were designing a horse, it would need to have some number of teeth, and he'd use logic and figure out how many teeth a horse should have. There was a big change over the following 100 years. Plato was born around 428 BC and died around 348 BC. Excuse me if I have to use notes for history. I was never very good at history. Aristotle had essentially a diametrically opposed view of what it means to understand the world. Aristotle was an experimentalist. And his idea of understanding the world was to go out and observe and then try to describe his observations. I don't know if he actually disagreed with Plato about the existence of the idealized world, but he wanted to focus his attention on that part of the world that we can see. So he became essentially an experimentalist and was extremely successful at what he did. His description of the world survived for 2,000 years. Unfortunately, they kind of fell out of the practice of reading what Aristotle said, because what Aristotle said fundamentally was, do the experiment, make the observations, and then say what you see. But because he was so successful at describing the world, everybody said, oh, well, he got it right. Why should we go out and look? Why should we do all that work? So they took his word for things and never questioned for 2,000 years, that, well, maybe he didn't get it exactly right. Maybe there's a better way. So it wasn't until the Renaissance in Europe, and I'm afraid I have something of a Eurocentric view of this, it wasn't until the Renaissance that people began to question, how do we see the world? There were some interesting changes about leading into the Renaissance. For instance, the mathematics that survived from antiquity was all geometry. That was all the mathematics that was known. Galileo just knew geometry. Galileo had a really neat quote about the universe being a book laid open before us, and the language that it's written in is geometry. There are some limitations to geometry, though. And there was a new piece that came in from the Arab world. And we now call it algebra, which is just a kind of a slurring of Arabic name for the original algebra book, which was Al-Jabar, I believe. So algebra was starting to make some progress in Europe, and Newton figured out how to use it. So it turns out that because of that work, the way that we describe the world changed. Instead of being very philosophical and very geometric, it started to become analytical and algebraic. So about this time, there came to be a method, which we think of as the scientific method. And I have an expectation that everybody kind of knows what the scientific method is. So I would like to ask for a description from the audience of what is the scientific method. And in fact, I'll even take some minutes here.
Reproducible.
All right, reproducible. What does it mean to be reproducible?
It always works on repetition.
If you do the same experiment over again, then?
It's good as long as it keeps working.
Ah, okay. Do people believe that that is a necessary part of the scientific method? Is that generally believed to be?
Somewhere in the middle, I think.
Somewhere in the middle. David?
Is that the complement of it being falsifiable? Say it's reproducible?
I'll record that. Two. But I haven't answered the question about whether these two items are different aspects of the same thing, or if they're really separate ideas.
We're going to start with hypothesis.
Okay.
Maybe start with an observation.
Yeah. Oh. So. Carolyn said, start with hypothesis. Whether or not that's the starting point is debatable, but let's wait on that a little bit. What do you do within a hypothesis?
Well, the hypothesis was based on some kind of idea that you had, or theory that you
were. Yeah. So there are a couple of things, actually a couple of things, that might lead into a hypothesis.
A theory leads into a hypothesis.
Is there some other source? Thank you, for hypotheses.
Observation.
You could have an you could imagine anyhow an atheoretical hypothesis. And then what do you do?
Test it.
And how do you do that?
Experiments.
We're back to Aristotle now. All right, so Aristotle really created this thing, although he may not have articulated it exactly the same way. Test it. My experiment. All right, and then what do you do?
Validate or not.
All right, so there are two possibilities in the testing. It could succeed, I'm gonna put that in quotation marks, or it could fail. I'll put that in quotation marks, too. What do you do if the experiment, can we agree on what it means for an experiment to succeed?
That it meets expectation.
That you've got your expectation and that the theory is supported by the experiment. I can't quite say confirmed, but supported anyhow. All right, so We're going to agree to call that a successful experiment. The flip side is that it could fail. What does that mean?
Disprove.
That something in the experiment does not support the theory.
All
right. Doesn't. All right. So succeed is meets expectation, does not meet expectation.
Is there time involved here now? Because we're not going to just do it once in this experiment.
That's the reproducible part, I think.
Yeah.
That one person ought to be able to do an experiment, say, hey, look at it, it worked. And then somebody else can try it and say, no, you messed with your data, I can tell, because it didn't work for me. That's been known to happen. Okay, so in the case that the experiment succeeded and that the theory is supported, what do we do next?
We write a paper.
Okay. And if the experiment fails, what do you do next?
You do it over again.
Do the experiment over again.
Yes.
Ah.
Or you rethink your original hypothesis.
You could rethink the hypothesis. But maybe Carol's suggestion comes first that, well, maybe I did something wrong. In fact, that is the standard science student response to a so-called failed experiment, that I must have done something wrong. Let's try it again. Right? And I would like to say that's not very scientific, although it's a good thing to do. I mean, you got a theory, you like it, you're a little bit emotionally invested in it. You don't want to just throw it out. So try the experiment over again, particularly if you can think of something that really was wrong with the way you set up the experiment. Sure, try it again. But at some point, if it keeps failing, you really ought to say, I guess my theory wasn't as good as I thought it was. And you could go back and rethink it. Rethinking leads to lots of options. Throw it out. It's wrong. Maybe the failed experiment gives you some more information that would allow you to modify the experiment, the theory, and make it better. Do we still have to call it a failed experiment then?
Well, I think that it may have failed, but that doesn't mean you didn't learn something.
Yeah, I guess failure. We've agreed on what it means to fail. We didn't get our expectation. But I don't think we should redefine that word. That I don't think that's a failure. I think if we come up with a better theory out of it, it was very successful.
Yeah.
That doing that experiment brought us right where we should have been.
So we need a better word, one that's...
More neutral at least.
Yeah.
All right, so there are these possibilities. And I guess both of them lead back a hypothesis. Now, it doesn't really look like a cycle, but yeah, there's a cycle over here of hypothesis testing and back to hypothesis that goes around, and in fact, you could go multiple times around a loop like that. So, I don't know, when I first learned scientific method, it was a kind of a start here and go, and now I'm thinking, this is why I'm picking on Carolyn, who said, you start with this. No, you could start actually anywhere in the loop. You could start with somebody's experiment that they thought failed. Say, that gives me an idea, so now I have a new theory. So you started with an experiment. Slightly weird, but you could do that. You can start anywhere in the cycle. And I would maintain that's still scientific method. Are people persuaded by the scientific method? So, all right. Are people in this audience persuaded by the scientific method? Show of hands.
It's not necessarily...
Almost uniform.
It's not necessarily the only thing. I mean...
What are the alternatives?
There could be things that exist that are not proven scientifically or that...
Ah.
And when faith conflicts with the scientific method, such as evolution and creationism...
Don't get me started. I think that is philosophically a very interesting place to go, and if I get on that, I'm not going to not going to get very far in my physics.
But for a long time, this method was believed in, people felt, scientists felt, that there were always causes and effects, and that we could really rely on this method to find the answers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't think it's true now, because I think we've found other things that are not predictable, and that you can't, especially quantum mechanics.
Yeah. However, that's a nice example of a theory where multiple results are expected now, that the, and they actually created a theory that allows for that. They have a system that on which they're going to take some measurements, and they're not going to say the answer will be 3 every time I do this experiment. They're going to say, well, this time it could be 3 or 5 or 7, and next time it'll be 1 of those 2. And in fact, I could even predict what the probabilities are, so that half the time it will be 3, a quarter of the time it'll be 5, and a quarter of the time it'll be 7. So quantum mechanics benefited or arose out of essentially a failed experiment. They could not predict the outcome of a measurement. But they could predict the outcome of 100 measurements. Very nice example.
Well,
thank you.
Still putting some kind of
it really does. I mean, it was a worm that almost got away, and at the turn of the century, they were very worried about it. Gee, you know, we thought we could predict the whole world. And then they found that they couldn't, and created a better theory that now does predict the outcome, but not individual outcomes. David had a comment earlier about falsifiable, going back to the question of the debate between creationism and other science and evolution. That I think the notion of falsifiable is central to scientific method. That if you've got a theory that just isn't falsifiable, that is, you can say there will never be an experiment that'll make me give up on this theory, it's not scientific theory. I need to stay off the soapbox. Okay, so most people here feel that they are persuaded by the results of the scientific method. Good. Because there's a problem for learning science that I would like to spend some time talking about. Starting around the beginning of this century, there was a Swiss psychologist named Jean Piaget, who did some very interesting work about how people learn. Mostly his work was done on his own children. He observed them very closely and came up with what I think of as really outrageous theories about what was going on in their minds. But as he tested his theories, more largely than just on his children, they really seem to hold up and now are the basis for a lot of pedagogical work, pedagogical understanding. Piaget had proposed like 2 methods by which we understand the world. The first of them is called assimilation, that children, and I think adults too, observe the world and theorize about it. And they may not consciously theorize, but we're curious about how the world works. As we're observing the world, we're building up a theory of how the world works. You may watch a 2-year-old repeatedly dropping. You may watch an 8-month-old repeatedly grasping, right? They're learning how the world works, first how their body works, and then how the world works. You know, the 2-year-old dropping things, and mother goes crazy because she's got to keep picking it up. Sorry, it's not just the mother. Maybe the father does that too. And you wonder, what is this game? Well, they're testing the world. They're checking out gravity. And we may not think of it as a scientific experiment, And we may really get tired of picking up whatever is dropping, but they're looking for a reproducible result. They're testing the world. And I think this goes on naturally. And every time the child does an experiment, or an adult does an experiment, or makes an observation that fits in with the way they see the world working, they assimilate that new, slightly new piece of information into their worldview. Every once in a while, however, an observation comes along that doesn't fit. And they have to kind of break down their worldview and shake things up a little bit in order to fit in this new piece, right? And when the things resettle and they fit again, the new piece has been accommodated. The new understanding is different from what it was before. I mean, kind of significantly different. You could say that the understanding was different after an episode of assimilation as well, because it was more robust and it was, you know, had more evidence for it. But the change is relatively small. When you have to accommodate a new piece, that's a significant change. And accommodation is what was going on in the world at the time of Newton. Everybody had assimilated all of Aristotle's theory. They kept doing little observations, say, yeah, he was right. Yeah, he got it right. We don't have to do any more experiments. But when Newton came along, he said, no, I see it differently. And we're really going to have to change the way we think. We're going to have to use algebra. That was a serious piece of accommodation. We're going to have to use a whole new language to talk about the world. But more than that, there were some real changes in the way that we intuitively see the world. Even if you never study physics, never study algebra, there are some things that you have to just change the way that you see the world. And I would like to do an experiment. This is not a physics experiment. You are the subjects, and I'm supposed to get signed permission slips from everybody to do human subject research here. But I won't. But anybody that doesn't want to participate in this, you don't have to participate in this. I hope you will. I have a device, which is a piece of plastic pipe with a little window cut out in it. And I'm going to put that on here. I'm going to put a little marble inside, and I'm going to spin the marble inside the tube. And in order to talk about this a little bit better, I'm going to just draw what the marble sees. There's the bottom edge of the tube, right? And I'm going to spin the marble starting here, right around like that. And the marble is going to arrive at this window. And the window is tall enough that the marble can go through it. Everybody understand the situation here? And what I want to do is to ask you to make a prediction of what will be the path of the marble. You've got to hold your tongue. He's already had my physics class and done this experiment. What will be the path of the marble when it gets to the window? And in case you would like to draw that, I didn't plan far enough ahead to bring little tables for everybody, but I did bring some paper. And if anybody needs a pencil, I don't have enough pencils either. Now I do. Can I circulate these? They will write on paper, I think. Maybe people brought their own pencils. I would like for you to make a prediction of where the marble will go when it gets to the window of the pipe. And let me not prejudice this by making it multiple choice yet, but I've got a slide that will reduce this, because I have a prejudice about what your answers are going to be. I'm just going to flick it with my finger inside the pipe. I'm going to put the marble right there, and push it with my finger so that it spins around inside the pipe. All right, and then it's going to get to the window, and I would like to know what it does when it gets to the window. Oh, and since people are being quiet, let me stir things up a little bit. There is a, occasionally when I've asked my physics class this question, they said, well, it depends. So if you believe that it depends on something that I haven't told you, write that down. Right, tell me what does it depend on. And you know, if you say, well, if it's this, then this happens, and if it's that, then that happens. If you can really articulate the whole thing, wonderful. Does everybody have an answer pretty well settled in your minds? There's one other thing that I've been learning about during my sabbatical, and that is that it does essentially no good for me to tell you the answer to this thing.
You have to give us the answer.
No, I don't have to give you the answer. There are two other strategies, and I would like to try both of them. One of them is to have you talk to the person next to you, or you can might into split into threes if there are any orphans left, and see if you can persuade the people around you of your answer, or be open-minded, let them persuade you, and it's even conceivable that you already agree, which is kind of boring, but it's conceivable. Shall we reconvene? Has everybody either persuaded or been persuaded? Let's see. How many people changed your minds during this conversation? That is, were persuaded by your neighbors?
I was surprised by my neighbors.
But they were not able to persuade you?
No.
No. Did you persuade them?
Not on a time of relationship.
Yeah.
I mean, they came up with things I didn't think of.
Okay. Let me take a little bit of a break from physics, because I'd like also to talk a little bit about pedagogy, because that's the important part of my life right now. Understanding is a socially constructed phenomenon. It is not something that you do all by yourself. You need to talk with other people about it. In particular, talking about things clarifies what we understand. That if we just hold a belief to ourselves, it can be very vague. And I think because of that, it's hard to instruct about. That if you held a view that I'm going to try to persuade you isn't true, but you weren't really clear that you held that view, if I now show you some other piece of reality, a week from now, you'll go right back to believing what you used to believe. There have been experiments done on that in education classes, that these preconceptions, that is the way you understand the world before you're instructed, are persistent. You've held those beliefs all your life, or been constructing them all your life. You're not going to change them because I tell you. You're not even going to change them because I show you. It's important that you know that you have some belief so that you can decide for yourself if you want to continue holding that belief or not. So the point, as far as I'm concerned, of having this particular discussion was to help solidify your theory. And in fact, that's probably a good reason for publishing, just to get your theory articulated as cleanly as you can. So I think you've mini published here, and have a theory. I have written what I think of as four theories on the board, and I don't know if this is an exhaustive list. My theory number A is that the marble will come straight out radially away from the center of the pipe. Does anybody believe that? Not a popular theory. All right. I don't believe it either. It goes that way. Is that a more popular theory than A? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Getting more popular. Is this a bandwagon people are jumping on?
B is good.
B is good. I think I counted 7. 0. 7 people go that way. Path C, I'm thinking of as a kind of a spiral path, that the marble is going outwards from the center, but it continues going around just as it was when it was on the inside. How many people would? C is this curve that spirals outwards from the pipe. Yeah? So you were formerly one of these, and now you want?
B, now I
want to be C. All right, make that a 6. How many C's do I have now? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 of them. And either I've missed something. Oh, all right, let's go with D. D means it just continues going around doing what it was doing. I see a lot of nodding. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, oh, a bunch of them. Oh, now I'm hearing the depends upon. What does it depend upon?
The velocity.
The velocity. The marble is as spherical as they could make it.
We don't know that.
All right, now you do.
Is the table level?
The table is quite level. You don't know that either. Okay, so it depends on the shape of the marble. And the levelness of the table. And what's the quotation? The billiard sharp whom anyone catches is doomed extremely hard. He's made to dwell in a dungeon cell on a spot that's always barred. And there he plays extravagant matches in figureless finger stalls on a cloth untrue with a twisted cue and elliptical billiard balls. This ball is round, and the table is fair, and there's no cue.
Size of the window.
The size of the window is big enough that the marble can get out.
No, I'm sorry, not the height of the window.
Yeah.
The
it's also wide enough that if the marble chooses to go out, it can get out. Excuse me, I'm personifying the ball here. The length of the arc. I don't know how to describe it.
Is it a third of the arc?
It's probably a sixth. Yes, it's a sixth. Okay.
Is the marble spinning or not?
It's going to kind of roll around. I can't describe exactly how it spins, but it is rolling on the table and rolling along the inside of the plastic at the same time. Whatever that means.
Orbiting and rotating?
I think we'll find it is revolving and rotating, yes. The spin on the ball, I can tell you from my own experience, makes minimal difference. You will not observe any difference because of the spin.
Is the ring stationary?
The ring will be stationary when I do this, yes. I'm going
to,
yes, that's the other way. We can talk about it and see if we can persuade each other, but at the end, we've got to do the experiment, right? And that's why I was asking if the scientific method is persuasive to you, because you all have a theory about what's going to happen. And clearly, some of you are going to have to change your mind. But let's do the experiment.
Yay!
I see some surprised faces.
I want to do it again.
I'll do it again.
Yeah.
Right? This is supposed to be a reproducible experiment. If I didn't lose the marble, I can do it. Now, shall I do it?
Go the other way.
Exactly the same? No, well, I'm going to turn everything over if I do it the other way. Should I do it faster, slower, exactly the same?
Put the marble nearer the opening and send it the other way.
No.
The opening's still there.
All right. Well, let me do it this way first. Reproducible experiment. I'll go slower this time. Maybe it'll be easier to see.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Hey, wait a minute.
That was a surprise for me. I don't know why it did that.
Do it again.
The method was a slow roll.
Yeah, try the slow roll.
That was closer to the straight line. Okay, so turn it over. Do you want the paths?
If
I turn the whole thing over, then I can spin it the other way. Oh, and I've got to stand out of the way somehow. No, I don't have it lined up right. There. All right. So, in spite of the popular preferences, the bees have it. Right? Science really is not very democratic. That was a bee. All right. So, what I think this illustrates is Newton's first law, that an object at rest tends to stay at rest. I didn't actually demonstrate that part. That's this part. So much for staying at rest. Boy, I should have done more experiments before I came in here. Let's see if I can plunk this thing down a little better. There. An object at rest tends to stay at rest unless it's acted upon by some outside force, unbalanced force. So what do you think was going on when it wandered off?
When it wandered off, the table was unbeaten.
Or the marble wasn't round.
Yeah, or maybe I didn't really put it at rest. You know, and it kind of staggered a little bit. There are lots of explanations. Now it's at rest, and it seems to be staying there.
Unless we believe that the marble has some sentience, you know, it's got some intentionality in it.
Yeah. We have been trained not to expect that anymore. That we call marbles inanimate objects. I guess maybe that's the distinction between animate objects and inanimate objects. We think of most of the world as being inanimate, and it doesn't just wander off under its own volition. It has no volition. And in fact, that's kind of the domain of physics. You could almost kind of cut out the rest of the world and say, all that stuff that has volition isn't physics. Right? But inert objects, that's what physics studies in a very specific way. But so I'm not going to answer David seriously because that's not physics. Okay, so there it sits at rest. And if it's already moving, it tends to go in a straight line unless it's acted upon by a force. So what does the pipe have to do with that? Why did I need the pipe for this experiment? Yeah. In order for the marble to go in a circle, it needed a force. And the pipe did it. But when it got to the window, the pipe stopped doing that. There was no force acting on the marble, and it went straight. Right, so that's what Newton's first law is all about.
Peter, the marble would have, in a sense, have been going straight as it went around, except that the force was bending it.
Right.
Direction.
That there was a force by the plastic pushing it in the direction that its motion was changing. And I sound like I'm speaking babble here, but I wanted to say it precisely in spite of the fact that there's no math prerequisite for being here. It turns out when you go in a uniform circle, there is acceleration toward the center. And the force that the plastic exerted on the marble was toward the center. It's called the centripetal force that makes things go around. The so-called centrifugal force is not a force at all. But you'll have to take physics to take it into centrifugal force. But the centripetal force was the force that the plastic was exerting on the marble that made it go around in its circular path.
So when it went through the opening and went in its straight line, that was the original straight line that it was trying to do when it was going around?
No, that was the straight line that it was doing when it got to here, right?
Oh, okay.
It came around all of this time. There was a force acting on it, so it was not going in a straight line. It was accelerating toward the center. But when it got to here, that force ended. So now the second clause of the law applies. There is no outside force, so the object continues in a straight line at a constant speed. That's what we saw, at least when I did it fast enough. So, That's the first law.
Why was that so revolutionary?
Say it louder.
Excuse me. Why was that so revolutionary a law?
Ah, thank you. I skipped over that part. It's revolutionary because of Aristotle's description that everybody in the world believed. Aristotle, in order to create a theory that described everything people could see, had two separate worlds. In the heavens, where everything is perfect. Right? That's where people go if they're perfect. So that everything up there is perfect. And everybody knows that the circle is the most perfect shape. So in the heavens, the natural motion of everything up there is uniform circular motion. Anything that's moving, all the planets go around on circular orbits. This was before Kepler. All of the stars are stuck on spheres, and therefore, as the spheres spin, are moving in perfect circles. The natural state of affairs in the heavens is uniform circular motion.
Did Aristotle think that the world was round?
I believe that he did. It was known around his time. They even knew how big it was. Eratosthenes measured the circumference of the Earth a long time ago. On the Earth, however, which is corrupt and different from the heavens, the natural state of affairs is rest. Look around you. Anything that's not being actively pushed is at rest. However, there are these four elements, and each one of them has its own place that it would be at rest. You know, and the Earth is at the center, and the water is around that, not as close to the center. And the air is above that, and the fire actually tries to rise up through the air. So there's a natural separation of stuff that can only be altered by some kind of activity. I think he even called it violence. So he had these two sets of rules that described what was seen. And everybody believed it. So when Newton came along, he really had to point out to people, no, I'm going to start with an entirely different way of looking at things. And in fact, if you look at his first two laws, first one is just this object at rest and all that stuff. But the second one is in algebraic. It's in the new language, F equals MA. That if you have a mass with an unbalanced force exerted on it, the mass will accelerate. And the magnitude of the acceleration is proportional to the force. The bigger the force, the more the acceleration. Oh, but it isn't just that the bigger the force, the more the acceleration. The fact that they are proportional is a very specific numeric relationship. The bigger the mass, for a given force, however, the bigger the mass, the smaller the acceleration. Right? That's why when a VW and a Cadillac collide, the VW does all the accelerating, well, most of it. Right? That's the reason to drive a Cadillac, that you don't accelerate as much when you get into a collision. Actually, everything that's in law number two, no, excuse me, everything that's in law number one is in law number two. An object at rest tends to stay at rest, means if there's no force, there's no acceleration. If it's at rest, it stays there. If it is moving, it does that, it continues to do that too, in a straight line. No acceleration in the absence of a force. Well, that's what law number two says. If F equals zero, then A has to be zero. So everything that's in law one is in law two. He could have gotten away without law one altogether, except that the audience that he was speaking to needed to wake up call. They needed to be told Aristotle was wrong. Here's my way of looking at things. So rule number one really is stated just for contrast with the predecessor theory. If he didn't need to do that, he wouldn't have needed to write out rule number one at all. Oh, let's see. Rule number three is a whole nother hour, and I think maybe I'm not going to get into it. If anybody wants to talk about Newton's third law, which is an analysis of forces between objects, it's very interesting, I think. Maybe I'm warped. Very interesting to do a careful analysis using the third law. But not today. All right. So what I think I've done is to talk somewhat about worldviews and a progress of worldviews through history. I think that we have seen a very nearly parallel progress of worldviews in the audience, that people held what was essentially an Aristotelian worldview about what the marble would do. That it was the natural thing was to be going in circles, and a lot of people said, this marble is just going to go in circles. That's what it's doing. Not exactly Aristotle, but fairly close. And you all have a Newtonian view now, don't you?
Yes.
That the marble, when it's moving, but in the absence of the force, continues in a straight line. All right, so by doing a scientific experiment, a person can, in effect, retrace this historical journey from an Aristotelian view to a Newtonian view. For those among you that are teachers or think of being teachers, I recommend that you take that very seriously, that the preconceptions with which people come to a class are very persistent. They have been worked on for a lifetime, and they will not be let go of gracefully or easily. You've been very graceful. So if you want to change someone's conception of how the world works, you need to work very hard at it and invite the learner to seriously grapple with the way they believe things. There's a backup, there's a fallback position on this. It may very well be that you were not completely persuaded by this demonstration, and that a week from now you will go back to your Aristotelian view. That is entirely possible, and I'm not going to test you. Amy might. All right, but in 2 weeks, and longer than, by the end of the semester, it's up to you whether you continue to believe the Newtonian view. So here's my fallback position. You may continue to keep in your mind whatever you believe. But I hope that you will, in addition, hold in your mind the Newtonian view. And if anyone asks you a question, like maybe you're going to be an engineer and somebody's going to ask you a serious question, you now have a choice of which of the two worldviews you would use to answer the question. And I hope you'll be able to make a decent choice.